M Rounds on the Future of Public Health. I'm Linda Fried, and I have the honor of serving as the dean here for this magnificent school. As you know, this year we have devoted this Grand Rounds series to understanding the existing public health system within the United States and what is needed to strengthen it, to lead in the creation of population health for the 21st century, leading in making our population healthier, and providing the essential capabilities that enable us to be better prepared and protected against many events, including the next epidemic. The U.S. National Academy of Medicine's definition of public health is the actions we must take collectively to protect the health of the public. This implicitly recognizes the essential role of government to provide the public goods that benefit us all, and that public health itself is a public good, translating science into impact for everyone. No one is excluded, everyone elevated, and all gain. The US public health system operates at federal, state, and local levels, implementing what has been defined as the 10 essential public health services with the goals of assessment, assurance, and policy development for the public's health. As we consider today the U.S. response to this pandemic as a basis for imagining and reimagining what we need for the future, no discussion of the public health system would be complete without an examination of the distinct roles and interplay between the federal, state, and local public health systems, and what the pandemic has revealed about strengths, flaws, and challenges. Perhaps among this audience, it would go without saying that, of course, we need a public health system that works across national and local levels with distinct and complementary as well as aligned roles at each level. But our experience from the past year provides evidence that the U.S. has not adequately defined, empowered, invested in, or aligned our public health system. This should not be a surprise. The 1988 Institute of Medicine report said that the US public health system at that time was in disarray as a result of years of neglect and lack of investment to modernize. The report called then for reinvestment, which has not happened. The pandemic, in a way, is a call to arms to assess what we need and to imagine and invest in getting there. So today's Grand Rounds brings us two leaders at the federal and the local level in New York City to consider what we've learned from COVID about the function and dysfunction and needs for the future in our U.S. public health system. And I am really thrilled and honored to introduce our two guests today. I start first with Sylvia Matthews Burwell, who is the 15th president of American University. President Burwell previously served as the Secretary for the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services under President Barack Obama, as well as serving before that as the Director of the White House Office of Management and Budget. In this past year, President Burwell was asked by the Council on Foreign Relations to chair or to co-chair an independent task force whose charge was to analyze the U.S. and global responses to this pandemic and provide goals and strategies for the United States and our global multilateral system to improve our system's response for the inevitable next pandemic. The resulting report, entitled Improving Pandemic Preparedness, Lessons from COVID-19, offers us a roadmap to get there. I'm also thrilled to introduce somebody who needs no introduction in New York, our health commissioner for New York City, Dr. David Chokshi. Dr. Chokshi leads what I consider to be a top local health department in the world with, and I quote from a prior health commissioner, Tom Frieden, a long tradition of innovation and leadership in transforming and retransforming the delivery of public health, grounded always in the basic science of public health epidemiology, and leading with surveillance and analysis, effective programs in our communities and across our cities, policy change, communications, and collaboration with medical care. Dr. Chokshi's perspective on what we've learned about how to build back and lead better from this pandemic and the roles of local health departments and what they need from the federal system will be of great value in this conversation. Dr. Chokshi's prior work experience spans the public, private, and nonprofit sectors, including positions with the New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation, the New York City and State Departments of Health, and the Louisiana Department of Health. We're going to benefit from opening statements by each of our two speakers, and then we will have a discussion among the three of us and invite questions from the audience. Please place them in the chat box, and we will work to spend a considerable amount of this time addressing the questions you raise. For those of you who were unable to attend our previous events, I strongly encourage you to visit our YouTube channel where you can find the recordings of our grand rounds from earlier this year. And with that, I'd like to welcome President Burwell and ask you if you can help us open this discussion.
Sure, thanks so much for having me today and for focusing on this conversation. And I'll start with sort of an overarching thesis about, as we think about improving public health and coming out of the pandemic, that 80% of what we need to do is doing what we already know or knew about and doing that better. And about 20% of this is about new opportunities that the pandemic and where we are in a trajectory of health exists. And so I wanna make sure we have plenty of time for discussion. So I'm just gonna touch on sort of three specific areas that I think are ways to frame and think about these improvements in public health that we need coming out of the pandemic. The first one I want to start with is high quality execution. This gets to why my thesis is that about 80% of what we need to do, we actually know, and it's a matter of how we carry it out. And this was a big point in the Council on Foreign Relations Task Force and the report we did. It focused deeply on the question of we needed better execution, and things that it specifically focused on are things like a national framework, something that I think we now have as a nation. We're getting to that place where we have, but did not have for an extended period of time. That's something we know. It's something we didn't do. The questions of execution with regard to issues like testing and the importance of testing, both in terms of disease prevention and understanding something that is an evolving thing. Another area of execution that I would highlight in terms of improving public health is that collaboration with state and local entities, as well as the healthcare system. That was a place that we know that is necessary. It's necessary for both public health and combating pandemics, but wasn't executed well. And then another area where I would highlight that it's just about execution, we know, and that's clear science-based communication. I would say another area that falls into this category, those are all covered in the report that I mentioned. Another thing I think it's important to highlight is just the basics that we know: prevention, detection, response. We know that's actually an approach that we use in pandemics. It's an approach that we use in most areas of public health. And we didn't frame the conversation that way. We didn't do the problem solving that way. And just that's something we know. And it's a very basic thing. And you would think that at this point in the pandemic, a year in, that most citizens in the country would get, okay, it's about prevention, detection, and response. That's what we have to do. Here's my role in that. Here's the government's role. But we're not in a space. And I would say this high quality execution can occur. And I'll give you a very specific example in Ebola. And while Ebola, very different disease, different trajectory, different scale and magnitude. Certainly the mortality of Ebola is very high, but I recognize its penetration in our nation is not anywhere near where we are. But just the idea of a quality example of public health being executed well, I would give the example of how individuals were tracked, because it was through the public health system locally. but that was in connection all the way with an overarching strategy for our nation, that when individuals who might have been in places where they possibly could have been exposed were going to be tracked for the 21-day period. And that was occurring at a local public health system. Those were the people who were making the phone calls, doing the temperature checks, reporting in. So there was data and analytics that we knew. That data and analytics helped us understand how many cases that we had in the country, where we could potentially have spread. And it also helped you understand the disease and the disease trajectory because you had a series of information. So I give that as an example of we can execute well. We do know how to do it. The second point I want to make is the need for a stronger basic public health system. And this was the point that Linda, I think, made and made so well and went into some of the specifics. And when I say a stronger public health system, I mean both in terms of infrastructure as well as the network of players that contribute. And we need to think about both of those pieces being stronger. And what I am hopeful is that it is a pivotal moment, that the pandemic provides a pivotal moment. And that, if you ask me, if there was anything that that council task force could do to change things, to actually have impact by doing a report, it would be to get more and more people to understand that we have to think about pandemics in public health, not as nice to haves. It is essential. And it is essential from the perspective of compare it to the other things that we invest in. Our national security in terms of the Defense Department, which has a very large budget over extended periods of time. Think about how we invest in our economic security as a nation. And what we've learned through this pandemic, but we have to internalize and act upon, is that a pandemic endangers our national security, our health security, our economic security in ways that other threats that we invest in very real ways, it has done it more. Think about the mortality and the last few wars that we fought. Think about the economic damage that has occurred in the last few wars. And so it needs to be put in that context and then acted upon. What kind of actions, what kind of acting do I mean? Number one, get the investments in public health infrastructure. Those are, we can go through in more detail, but that's one. Number two, build the networks of relationships from the World Health Organization and bilateral relationships in countries all the way to local public health departments. That needs to be in place for both public health and pandemics. Number three, we need the basics of local public health working. So that we can depend on it. And I'm going to give you a specific example again of where we saw this, and it's related to Ebola. The day I heard that there was a case of Ebola in Lagos, Nigeria, many of the people on this call will understand and know Lagos in terms of its density, in terms of a number of things. The idea that this disease was going to spread and spread that quickly through Africa's most populous nation, the economic anchor of Western Africa, was just a devastating piece of news. But what was there was a basic on the public health system. Very quickly, they used the infrastructure that had been built for polio vaccinations. When we're trying to get rid of polio in Nigeria, and having worked on this when I was at the Gates Foundation, that basic infrastructure was the backbone of what was used to contain, to prevent, detect, respond, to do the contact tracing. So a very specific example of when you have that public health system in place, how it can flip to help with the pandemic. The other thing, when I say basics, we need quality, affordable healthcare for everyone. We need accessible, affordable, quality healthcare, because that stops the comorbidities that have led to many of the deaths that we've seen in this. And it is also the system that people go to when there's a pandemic. Last point I just want to make is the incorporation of data and technology. And I think this would be in my 20% new in terms of how I think about that. And you can see that in so many ways as we're seeing and we think about data and technology, that creation of that vaccine with the speed. What an incredible thing that the science has done and the technology has done. A new type of vaccine, as we all know, that we are now using. But also this idea of the importance of data. And I would just highlight the issues of surveillance as we think about the importance of data and how to use it, and use it in ways people don't like Big Brother. They don't like government surveilling, and the word itself even conjures things. But we all have our phones. People aren't as concerned about that. And so how do we think through the questions of using individual information, information in the healthcare system, information in the public health system, to do the kind of appropriate surveillance that can help us both keep it a pandemic at bay and give us the time to learn and understand enough that we can do a better job? With that, there's a lot in there that we could discuss more, and I'll stop.
Sorry. Now I'd like to turn to Commissioner Chokshi. Dave?
Well, thank you so much. I'm just delighted to be joining you this morning. Thank you, Dean Fried. It's a real honor to get to share the virtual stage with you, President Burwell. And I also wanted to thank everyone at the Mailman School for organizing this, and also for being so patient through the back and forth of whether I would actually be well enough to participate today. As some of you know, I was recently diagnosed with COVID-19 myself, but am grateful that my symptoms were mild and manageable. I wanted to start with that, actually, because my experience has been one more way in which COVID-19 has been humbling. And for me, at least, a fresh reminder that every case of COVID-19 is really about much more than one person's illness. It's about fear and anxiety for family and loved ones. And I think about the patients that I've treated as a primary care doctor, and recognize that in far too many cases, it involves worry about access to medical care, about income and job security, and really about, you know, so many other essential everyday things that, we too often take for granted. And so as we talk today about the future of public health, I wanted to start by encouraging us to keep in mind both the very large human scale, but also that smaller human scale of the virus, and also make the case that public health has a central role in managing that wide aperture lens of all of those aspects of well-being. As New York City's health commissioner, I often think back to the roots of the health department. You heard a little bit about this from Dean Fried. But the roots were grounded in how the practice of public health was institutionalized more broadly in the first place in New York City, but in so many ways, the practice of public health writ large around the world. And so much of this arose largely in response to pandemics. In New York, responding to cholera and smallpox and yellow fever in the 19th century, and tying that suffering, that tragedy, to the improved conditions in those years, improved sanitary conditions that were found to be key to curbing the spread of disease. Since then, public health has certainly evolved. But that lineage, I think, is so instructive for how we should think about the subsequent chapters of public health as well. I keep it in mind not only because of the once in a century pandemic that we're in, but also because it strikes me that there's a proven danger in not keeping it in mind once the immediate urgency of the moment has passed. We just have to think back to the catastrophic effects of the last once in a century pandemic, the 1918 influenza pandemic, when arguably not enough changed after the death and devastation that was experienced. In fact, some historians label it the forgotten pandemic for that reason. And it strikes me that we have a real opportunity right now in this moment, and it is really up to us as to whether COVID-19 too will recede from memory with not enough changing, or whether we will have the wherewithal to turn the unspeakable tragedy of this pandemic into lasting change for public health. So I'm looking forward, you know, most of all to a conversation about some of those long-term changes, but what we can do right now to set them in motion, even as we continue to respond to COVID, care for our sick, and vaccinate as rapidly and widely as possible. To see that discussion, I'll follow President Burwell's lead. I also have three sort of core ideas that I wanted to put forth and discuss very briefly. And I should start by saying each of them is inherently related to the other. First is the deep and abiding link between public health and economic policy. We have seen during the course of this pandemic that it is not an either or. We have a renewed chance, I think, to challenge the false dichotomy that too often rears its head in these discussions of the economy versus public health. And instead think about policies that can actually advance both together. Paid sick leave is perhaps the most obvious example in how this has played out during the pandemic and how vitally important it has been to both achieve public health aims, as well as to assure economic security. But my argument is that we have to go beyond this, particularly by reversing the decades of disinvestment in public health and actually taking this moment to demand major investments in prevention, as well as job creation, particularly for local public health. And I would argue being full-throated in tying that to the physical and economic security of communities themselves. The second point that I wanted to lay out is the notion of leading with equity in public health. COVID-19 has shown that health equity is not a sideshow. It's not an addition, something that we do beyond, you know, the main event in public health. Health equity is the main event. And all we have to do is look at the stark and dismaying outcomes with respect to deaths and hospitalizations, particularly among Black and Brown communities in the United States, to realize that equity has to be a core part of our job as public health practitioners. This starts by acknowledging that there can be no more denying that the historical and ongoing legacy of structural racism is one of the greatest threats to public health. We've tried to do this in several ways at the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, starting by enshrining and elevating equity as one of our three core values, along with science and compassion. And elevating equity to one of the fundamental things that we focus on, to me, it has helped us ensure that it is baked into all of our work rather than, again, being seen as a parallel path that we need to travel along with our core work. It is the core work. I appointed our first ever chief equity officer, Dr. Torian Easterling, who serves as the first deputy commissioner as well, when I took the helm, and charged him with making sure that we both turn the spotlight inward and understand how we need to think about equity within our own organization, but then link that up to our external equity efforts as well. And pushing so that we're not just in public health talking about the data around disparities, but answering the so what question. What are we going to do about it? How do we get to the point of legitimate community engagement, whether it's about COVID-19 testing or about a COVID-19 vaccine, so that we're having the sometimes difficult, but honest and necessary conversations about how it is that we in public health are actually worthy of the trust of the communities that we aim to serve. The third point that I wanted to start with is the notion of bridging public health and healthcare delivery. This is something else that COVID-19 has really brought into stark relief. For example, the effectiveness of social distancing directly translates into the number of sick patients that we see ending up in our emergency departments and intensive care units. For those of us in public health who have seen this channel before, how the policy and environmental approaches, you know, often undergird what we think of as traditional public health, but then how that translates into when people get sick enough to require healthcare. It's something that is well trodden, perhaps in the way that we think about public health, but it's something where the connection between these things has become much more tangible and visceral for the layperson, for the general public, who now understands this link between what we do in public health and how that connects to what ends up happening in clinics and hospitals. So one of the things that I hope we will draw from and move forward with in the coming years is this idea that there is a nexus between public health and healthcare delivery. But we have to ensure that we're continuing to tear down the walls between those worlds so that we actually achieve what is our common cause across those fields, which is producing health. So just to wrap up my initial remarks, I wanted to take a look at the amazing progress that has been made with the development of the mRNA vaccines for COVID-19, really an astounding time. We've almost taken it for granted as we're seeing the news emerge. Certainly, I would not have predicted in March of last year that we would be in a place where we have two safe, effective, life-saving vaccines, and likely three or four just within the span of the next few weeks. I'm so struck by what we're seeing with respect to the pace of science and how it can be brought to bear when there is this societal will to commit to advancement in that way. It does remind me also of what I saw back in March and April of last year when, for example, even though we had been working for over a year on building our telehealth infrastructure, literally overnight at New York City Health and Hospitals, because we were in the stay-at-home phase of the surge, we shifted to hundreds of thousands of encounters, now millions of encounters to telehealth within the span of days. I also remember walking through my hospital, Bellevue Hospital, and within a matter of hours, an endoscopy suite, actually the waiting room of an endoscopy suite, was turned into a fully functional medical ICU, taking care of patients who were intubated and struggling with critical illness from COVID-19. All of these experiences are seared in my memory, you know, in so many ways as tragedy, but also as a testament to what can change when that will is there. So my great hope from the public health perspective is that we not forget this, that we make sure that when we are on the other side of this pandemic, we bring that same will to bear in terms of what we need to do to support and invest in public health. I'm talking about sustained investment over the long term, not just during an emergency, to make sure that we learn the lessons of how important it is to invest in prevention, to shore up our public health surveillance systems, to create these links that we've talked about across sectors that advance health, and that take the opportunity that we'll have through economic recovery to actually place public health as central to it, because we have learned that lesson, but we now have many more powerful tools to communicate it to our fellow citizens as well. So that's my big hope, you know, having seen what is possible over these last few months when smart, committed individuals band together, that we can take that same volition and turn it into something that is much more durable and long lasting. So I'll leave my opening thoughts there, and I'm looking forward to the conversation. Thank you again.
Thank you so much. For those of you in the audience, if you have questions, please enter them into the question and answer box at the bottom of your Zoom. And I'd like to start with a couple questions for both of you, following up on your comments. Maybe I'll start with, Dave, your first frame or your most recent frame around the issue of vulnerable communities in a pandemic and disparities. And honing in perhaps on how we actually take Sylvia's comments about the need to prevent, detect, and respond at a local as well as a national level, and tailor that to the needs of particular for the needs of our most vulnerable communities with a lot of comorbidities? What's the acute way response approaches that we need to develop for the future to be more effective? And what are the sustained approaches within the public health system, certainly in terms of creating access to medical care, and then more broadly in terms of economic investment?
Thanks. Well, this is an intricate and challenging question, I think is the right way to frame it. But for me, it simplifies things to realize that so much of achieving our equity imperative begins and ends with trust. You know, one of the ways that we have talked about this in the context of our COVID vaccination campaign is that trust is an essential ingredient for turning vaccines into vaccinations. And that, I think, just puts into perspective the time frame that we should have in mind when we're talking about what it means to deliver public health really on the ground in communities in ways that will actually be resonant with the people that we intend to serve. It starts by recognizing that in many cases, the starting point is a deficit of trust for important historical reasons. And frankly, you know, we don't just have to look back to the history. There are so many ways in which people are marginalized, you know, interacting with the systems that we have set in place to try to deliver health and healthcare. So what that leads us to is the notion of earning trust, being worthy of trust. And I think that, you know, for public health practitioners, what we have to do is recognize that there are certain roles that we play in generating trust, providing science-based information, ensuring that, you know, the very tangible delivery of services and executing on them well, as President Burwell alluded to, those are, you know, fundamental things that we have to bring to bear. But it also means taking a step back sometimes and allowing the institutions, the people, the messengers who may be more trusted in the communities that we aim to serve, and having them take a step forward to be the ones who are delivering messages, and importantly, listening in those communities, hiring from those communities, and making it so that our public health workforce actually looks more and more like the people who should be at the very top of the pyramid in terms of whom we're aiming to serve.
Thank you. Sylvia, from a federal perspective, I'm interested in where you think the federal response in a pandemic on the public health system side can address vulnerable communities and what it needs from the local health public health system.
So I think this issue of equity is incredibly important, and it is actually called out in our task force report, and it's a report at the Council on Foreign Relations, but the equity issue is one that we highlighted, perhaps didn't have as much expertise in resolving, but it is hugely important. When I think about the role of the federal government in this issue, I think the point that the commissioner made about trust is extremely important, a very important means to the end. But I think we as a nation and we as a public healthcare system and as a federal government need to be really specific about what are the outcomes we are seeking? What do we want? So it is 5 years from now, and what does success look like so that we get it done and we use the most important levers to get it done? And we need a world where we don't go into the next pandemic or the next issue with huge portions of our population having comorbidities that are extremely difficult and expose them more, that they do not, their social determinants of health create situations where they are more exposed to this disease. And I think about it in terms of we need people to have access to quality and use it. in terms of basic healthcare. That gets us to that prevention, detection, and response that we were talking about. And what we need to do is focus on what are the biggest levers. And remember that there are levers, as was stated, that are at the base a part of structural racism. And we know the statistics in terms of when we look at our populations of color and their service, when they actually even get access to healthcare. How do we go at that? What do we do in terms of training, in terms of our medical schools and making the changes that we know we need to help with things like that? How do we make sure there's access? In my comments, I mentioned this issue of quality, affordable healthcare. When the Affordable Care Act came into place, the biggest increases and those who had insurance and the biggest decreases in the uninsured were in our Latinx populations and in our Black populations. You've got to get access to that quality healthcare, but then you have to get use. And use is very related to the commissioner's point on trust as we think about that. In terms of quality and that use issue, when we talk about vaccines, as we think about the science, the specific science, we have to go at the issues of the trials and making sure that people are represented. So I think the way to approach this is to think about, from the federal government perspective, what are the outcomes we're all seeking? Where are the places where the federal government has the largest levers that it can use? The NIH can impact how we do trials. It is a huge player in terms of those issues. The federal government, while it is extremely difficult to work with issues of medical schools and how they think about this. But I believe we have to think about these questions. We had to think about it in another public health issue, which is pain. Physicians and how much they were trained in the space of pain, which is a big part of what led to the opioid epidemic. But so what we need to do from a federal government perspective is what outcomes, and then what are our biggest levers to use? And I think it's extremely important, though, to be specific and focus, because we want a situation where 5 years from now, what we see in terms of the disparity doesn't exist in a day-to-day healthcare and doesn't exist when we go into crisis and more extreme situations.
Thank you. Dave, the New York City Department of Health has been the nation's leader over the last 20 or 25 years in transforming the delivery of health into communities, complementing the role of access to medical care and the receipt of medical care. And the Department of Health has been a leader in implementing the science that says that half of chronic diseases are preventable and that a huge amount of that has to go on in our communities. What do we need to do coming out of this pandemic in the New York City Department of Health to lay the basis for preventing those chronic diseases which are and comorbidities which are causing so much risk in vulnerable communities?
Thanks for asking such an important question, and it really gets to the heart of a lot of what we have been talking about already. And I would echo the point that Sylvia just made, which is let's hold ourselves accountable. Right? If we are really trying to shore up our population to avoid the catastrophic outcomes that we have seen during COVID-19, a lot of that has to do not just with preparing for the next pandemic per se, but ensuring that we have a healthier population to begin with. And that, you know, at the end of the day, is the responsibility of public health. In terms of how to do that, you know, there are two sort of broad areas that come to mind for me. The first is where the health department has led, as you pointed out, for decades. And the second, I think, is charting some new directions. Where we have led, but where we need to continue to innovate, is with respect to what I think of as the policy or environmental approaches to prevent chronic disease. This asks, you know, the successive why questions. Why do some people get diabetes and high blood pressure and others don't? You know, what is it about their risk profile? What is it about what they are being exposed to in their everyday lives? And how do we actually create health promoting environments rather than obesogenic environments and the ones that, you know, that create illness. And so much of this has to do with the ways in which we structure our society. to make it so that physical activity becomes easier, to make it so that eating healthier is, you know, the natural choice rather than one that you either have to be wealthy or extremely knowledgeable, you know, to be able to do, making it so that salt, sugar, fat, you know, the things that we know contribute to so much chronic illness are not as omnipresent in our world. So it's about taking those policy and environmental approaches and, you know, essentially evolving them to get even more effective. And then I think the future directions here are really about making it so that we are doing this in the context of the neighborhoods that people are living in and interacting, again, with people who have the lived experience to be able to speak with community members and help to change their behaviors. I'm a big believer in the role of community health workers in, you know, being able to do this. One of the things that I've been most heartened by is the fact that there has been a conversation at the local level, state level, and the federal level for increased investment in community health workers. The Biden administration, as part of its COVID-19 response plan, has talked about a public health core, which shares a lot of commonalities with what we've been thinking of as a neighborhood health core as well. And I think that that could be a step change with respect to investing in the public health workforce, actually improving the health of the population today, but also having the personnel at the ready for pandemic response in the future as well.
Thank you. So I'm going to turn to our audience, and I'm looking at the questions in the Q&A box, and I'd like to start with a group of three, which are really all about communication. And each of you has spoken to the need for leadership in effective, transparent, and evidence-based communication that speaks to where people are at. The question, let's say, one question is about how the federal and local health, public health system should be communicating. The other is how the media should be sharing information in a more constructive way. And how do we motivate people's appreciation of what's needed? And I don't know, Sylvia or Dave?
So in terms of the federal and state and local relationships, when I was talking about that networking and that connectivity, it is about building the muscles so that that exists. And that is information flowing up, information flowing down. That's the way and creating the means by which that occurs and on a regular basis in non-pandemic settings is a very important part of that communication. I mean, how in Ebola we relied on local public health, how we relied on hospital systems, but making sure that you have means in place and relationships in place where people feel that they can be heard both ways. Is an extremely important thing. And that's what I meant by the networking infrastructure that needs to be built and be in place to do that. And that communication needs to be occurring at sort of the public health parts of the system, as well as the political parts of the system. When we were doing Ebola, at the same time I was having conversations with the governor, Tom Frieden in CDC, or Nikki Lurie, who was part of our emergency response efforts, were having conversations with colleagues throughout the public health system. And so I think that's a very important thing to have in place and the muscles built. And that's about also having the attention, which is why in the council report, we recommend that in the White House, there is a place where this is focused on, and it's a career person that is there for all time to have kind of continuity. So building that kind of network and that infrastructure for the network, very important. On the issue of communications and the media, I think that one of the things that if I were making recommendations, if I were asked in terms of media entities and for those who report on it and who are trying it or trying to get the right information, It is something that I think we need to think through, the difference between news and information. Hmm. And in a pandemic, that consistently repeating information, scientific information, is a very important thing that is actually different than, you know, it isn't necessarily what is what about what is new. It is about what is known in terms of as we think through. And when I think about the role of the federal government in a pandemic, in its simplest form, the federal government has two responsibilities, tools and communication. And the communication part of this, I learned very well during Ebola, when at one point I walked into, when I was meeting daily with the president, and the president looked at me and he said, Sylvia, you realize there have been more news articles about this than any other thing in my presidency. In terms of the importance of quality communication, the way you're communicating. During the Ebola, 17% of college students believed that they or someone they knew would get Ebola. You all are public health folks. You understand the numbers. We got a bunch of epidemiologists on here. And so you understand this importance of the communication is so very real. And the media has a role in that in terms of sharing specific quality information.
Thank you. Dave, what's the role of the local public health department in terms of communications?
We have a fundamental role, you know, with respect to communicating to the public. This is something that that I think about from the very first moment that I wake up in the morning, you know, to when I go to sleep at night. And frankly, I have dreams about it as well with respect to, you know, how to do it effectively. Because particularly during a pandemic, the importance of clear, succinct, well-framed communication makes the difference between, someone who may adopt a healthier behavior and not. So it is something that is, you know, part of our fundamental charge as the local health department. There are two points that I wanted to add to what Sylvia has laid out really well. The first is on this notion of framing. And I will, sort of take a look in the mirror as the field of public health and say, this isn't something that we always do well. We sometimes get caught up in our own jargon. We want to lay out all of the scientific nuances, sometimes in a way that muddies our message. And we have, you know, people who offer sometimes competing messages as well, because frankly, sometimes it's a bit messy. But I do think that we can do better if we take that step back and think about the framing for our public health messages. I'll just give you a couple of very concrete examples. We already talked about the notion of surveillance. You know, we talk about surveillance as a core public health function, and it is an immediate turnoff, you know, when people are thinking about what should be a wonderful and valuable thing in public health, which is really about assessment and protection. You know, fundamentally, surveillance is about protection. So why don't we talk about protection rather than using the word surveillance? The other thing that, I've always tried to keep foremost in mind for our own messages is focusing on the positive behavior, you know, the ones that you want to see, rather than always being sort of the finger wagging public health telling folks what they should not be doing. So for example, you know, when it comes to mask wearing, really emphasizing that in a place like New York City, actually the significant majority of the population is wearing masks. So why don't we talk about it in that context, setting the norm, you know, so that people say, hey, everyone else is doing this, you know, this is something that I should be getting with the program with as well. So anyway, all to say, just being more thoughtful about framing and doing it in a way that that makes us get out of our own way, you know, sometimes is really important for communication. And then the second piece, just very briefly, is it's not just about the message. It's also about the messenger. And again, if we have as our responsibility in public health, getting to the most marginalized, getting to communities who are not well served right now. That means that sometimes we have to have the humility to take a step back and say, it's not always going to be coming out of a doctor's mouth. You know, it may be a faith leader. It may be, you know, your barber. It may be, you know, someone else in the community whom you've built up a relationship with. And our job in public health is to arm them with the information that they need, and actually allow different messengers, and often more trusted messengers, to be the ones who are conveying the message.
Linda, because the communications thing is so important, just a couple more points about it. In a pandemic, the communications, it's so important because what we know evolves. Mm-hmm. And so actually, and to the point that Dave made, it's extremely important, and we all should have started with that. Helping everyone know this is a pandemic. What we know and what we don't know is going to evolve and change, both because we'll learn information, and a pandemic has a trajectory that most people aren't familiar with. And so even starting with the framing of what we want to make sure you know is that things will change. We will learn. And that would save you the, are you wearing masks at the beginning? Do you change? Do you now wear two masks? And everybody focusing on, well, you told me one and now you're telling me two. Was it, I wasn't safe? And so you get away from those kinds of things, to Dave's point about the importance of communication. The other one that I will give you as a very specific example of why it is so important to get the framing right. And this is a place where I think public health may need to work with others close to public health. It's the issue of the vaccine. The idea that these vaccines are as effective as they are, but people worry because it's not 100%. And if you started the conversation with reminding people, the FDA was going to approve something that was 50, or all of the vaccines that you take and feel great about every day, you know, the vast majority of them have a much lower level. And so how we framed that vaccination conversation fed into the fears that people had.
So fabulous. So I have a concluding question for each of you. Dave, actually, I'm going to bundle several questions which follow exactly on these last comments and on equity. And there are three questions which I'm going to put together. One is the vaccine safe? Two, what steps, why are New York City healthcare workers, 20 to 30% of providers, declining the COVID vaccination? And what are the issues in race and ethnicity that are playing a role in their educated workforce being resistant to getting vaccinated? And finally, what's the city doing to create equity and access to vaccination? Many communities of color don't seem to have equal access.
Yes, well, thank you. A very important series of questions. Let me try to succinctly get to as many of them as I can. Yes, the vaccine is safe, effective, and life-saving, period. We know this from very large clinical studies, over 44,000 people in the case of the Pfizer vaccine, over 30,000 people in the case of the Moderna vaccine. And even more importantly, we now have real-world experience from millions upon millions of Americans that shows that the vaccines are safe. And this is very important, you know, to get to the other parts of the question, which have to do with equity with respect to acceptance of vaccination and confidence in the vaccine, along with the steps that we're taking to ensure access as well as uptake of the vaccine. We have seen that, you know, different New Yorkers have varying levels of being confident in the vaccine. The most common reasons for this that we have heard are, you know, one, the pace at which the vaccines were tested and developed. And to that, you know, I often point out that the underlying technology for the vaccine was something that was developed over a period of years, and there were no shortcuts taken with respect to the clinical studies to actually test the vaccines. But it also has to do with one's own, you know, experiences in healthcare and the things that sort of color you know, how you interpret a healthcare intervention, whether it's vaccination or a different medicine. And for that, you know, I always invoke my own clinical experience. This is something where we have to meet people where they are. We have to listen. We have to answer questions. We have to realize that sometimes it's not going to take the first conversation to change someone's mind, but it's really about having multiple conversations and, again, empowering other people in communities so that if it's, you know, someone in a church group who wants to pose a question to another member of the church group, they have the information they need, you know, to get their questions answered. So that's part of addressing vaccine confidence. And then, you know, from the perspective of the health department, we still have work to do in this respect, but we are very actively placing our vaccination sites in the hardest hit communities, often communities of color, and making strides each day to ensure that even though we have a very limited supply of the vaccine, that it is targeted, you know, and appointments are reserved for the people who will most benefit from it. Those are folks who are at greatest risk of severe outcomes, including older New Yorkers, but also people who are at greater risk of exposure to COVID-19, often essential workers and often Black and Brown New Yorkers as well. So I could say a lot more, but let me leave it there in the interest of time.
Thank you. And Sylvia, for the last question in our last couple of minutes, what do you think Americans should be asking for in this new federal administration in terms of the what 5, 1, 3, and 5 years from now, a reinvigorated, reinvested in public health system should be able to deliver?
They should first and foremost ask for proven high quality execution to get us out of the pandemic. That's what's in front of us right now. And doing that will build the public health system. Doing it and doing it correctly, putting in place a national framework, putting in place the testing, vaccination, contact tracing capabilities, and knowing how to do that and executing across that network, bringing together the many pieces of our public health, our healthcare system to get the outcomes for now. And as they're doing that, make sure that those investments are going to continue. And that means direct investments into state and local public health systems. That means putting in place these networks and systems over time so that they stick, that they're not just used for the pandemic, making sure that you have the structures here in Washington, D.C., in terms of that it is a prioritized thing that is focused on. So it is both about dollars, it is about execution of what we have in front of us to learn how to do that well, and it is about the systems and networks that we need to expect from our federal government. And the other thing is we need the leadership, and that gets to the communication. We need to build the models and ways that it works and show that we can do it, like on this question that we were just talking about on vaccinations. One of the things is we got to do the next click, and the federal government has to be a part of that. Is part of the reason we're not getting it, part of the reason we know there are healthcare problems. People don't have transportation, even in those communities, to get to that site. People don't have, we're doing it in the hours when these essential workers, the social determinants of health, are blocking these people's ability, our communities of color's ability to get it. And so that's the other thing that we need to do, is have that equity lens that Dave started with. That is an expectation that I believe we should have of the federal government as we move forward in a better public health system and solving the pandemic.
President Burwell and Commissioner Chokshi, thank you for your immensely valuable comments today, for being part of us, and for your leadership. Deeply appreciated, and thanks to our audience for being together. Take good care.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Thank you for having us. Thank you.